John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today I have another exciting episode for you, and aloha, still in Hawaii here on Oahu. And now what we're going to share with you guys today is an awesome permaculture homestead. So this is a standard residential house on a standard residential lot without much land, but they're definitely growing a lot of food. So what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and walk up the driveway, show you what they're growing, not even in the backyard, in the front yard, but in the drive up to their place here. Then we're going to show you all the amazing things they're growing in the front yard. So let's check it out. All right, so now we're walking up the driveway and check it out. On one side, we got all these guys. Down low, you might not know what they are, but they're bananas. You guys can see these guys are super huge, super tall. As I back up, you'll see what it is. Look at that. How much would all those bananas cost in the store? Actually, these bananas are priceless, actually, because you can't buy these bananas in the store. This is a special variety of banana called Namwa. It's actually quite good and quite delicious. And look at those, man. I mean, there's so many bananas on there. And when they start ripening them up, I mean, they'll have bananas for days, if not weeks, depending on how many they eat. And they have a whole big patch of bananas here. And the cool thing is about this area, this is an area that wasn't growing any food prior, and things never really grew here. They actually put in an irrigation to get some water to it, started composting, adding a lot of organic matter to the soil, and the bananas started taking off. And check it out. And there's that big rack you guys saw right there. And here's like a banana bud, and here's just even more bananas growing. And if I look up, I mean, here's yet another bunch of bananas. And the cool thing is, when you grow your own food, you do not have to get the standard Cavendish bananas that they sell at the store. I mean, that's one variety. And if you're lucky, depending on where you live, you might be able to get up to four or five varieties of bananas. But man, there's like over hundreds of varieties of bananas that you can grow, and each one tastes different. I mean, some of the names of the bananas are like ice cream bananas. Imagine how the ice cream bananas taste, man. Apple bananas, so many different kinds. There's like red bananas, they're so cool. And then on the other side of their driveway up, you can see just the block wall there. They actually built a trellis, and this is the trellis they built out of just the wood existing on the property. It's a wet wood, so it's nice and bendable and flexible. And what they simply did was they just simply took some rope and they just tied it together. So it's just very simple and easy construction. We kind of got our nice rustic look going on. But you know, it doesn't matter what it looks like, because when this is filled up like it was just a few months ago with plants like the chayote or the lilikoi or the passion fruit, and here's some that's just still living. It was having some problems, and they're going to actually do a replanting soon. And this thing is like long. I mean, this thing's like 50 feet long trellis. This could have a lot of food grown on it. Now, in addition, besides growing up above the ground, they're actually growing down in the ground. So they got little things like mint and little herbs in the bottom. So when it gets shaded out, some of the greens, like the herbs, will do pretty well. In addition, another crop that does well right here is the aloe or the aloe vera. That's great for actually juicing or blending or even putting on wounds if you get hurt or sunburn. Might happen in Hawaii. In addition, near the bottom here, they got some cool fruits, some pineapples. I definitely love pineapples. Got some nice Hawaiian pineapples this trip. And there's a nice large one. And here's a little small baby pineapple. Look at that. So cute. And they got pineapples in different stages. You know, here's one over on this side that they just harvested for eating. Here's one that's gonna be ready soon. This one will be ready probably in just a few months. And here's one that hasn't quite made a pineapple yet. And here's one's even more baby. So they got them in all different stages so that they'll continually have a harvest of different pineapples to eat.
So now we're at the top of the driveway, and they got so much stuff going on. Like in front of me, you guys are gonna see in a minute, like they got raised beds or just mounds. So raised beds without the sides, growing like chard, radishes, arugula, beets, chard, and like dinosaur kale. And then behind me, you guys can see they got a whole bunch of different greenery growing. So they got the wonderberry growing, a tomato, they got a whole bunch of dinosaur kale, they got eggplant back there, and they got some cool Jamaican passion fruit or Jamaican lilikoi. And then over on this side, they got some taro or calo growing, many different varieties actually. Then they got a nice papaya tree all mixed into the landscape, and it looks really nice too. So, you know, if you want to grow some food, it can look really nice if you plan accordingly and plant it out right. Next, let's go ahead and do a couple close-up shots and show you what's exactly growing here. So now we're gonna share with you guys some of the specific plants they've had a lot of success with, and one of those guys is right here. This is known as the dinosaur kale, also known as Tuscan kale or black kale. It's a, these plants, believe it or not, are like 5 years old, right? Now, they weren't growing in this place for 5 years. They've only been growing here for 1 year. So you might be thinking, John, how did that happen? Well, they had a master plant, or the big mama plant, and over on the other side of the yard, they actually cut it and just literally cut the stem off and stuck these stems with no rooting hormone or anything into the ground. They made their own roots, maybe only about half of them actually, and then they grew up into their own plants. So this is an excellent way to keep your plants growing, so you don't have to keep replanting them. And dinosaur kale, definitely one of my favorite leafy greens to eat, but also to grow. They're very nutrient dense, have a lot of nutrients in them per calorie. Behind here, I don't know if you guys are seeing that, oh yeah, you guys are, is the eggplants. They got a nice eggplant here, and unlike northern climates, you know, here in the tropics, the eggplants will grow into a nice large bush tree-ish thing, depending on how well you stake them and train them and the variety. And it looks like they got a lot of ripe eggplants on there that they can harvest right now. And behind me over in that area, you can see their nice trellis that's filled in with their nice Jamaican passion fruit or lilikoi. And that's like a orange kind, and they're so sweet. They're so much better, in my opinion, than the standard yellow or the purple kind. So if you want to grow a nice edible crop here in Hawaii that will yield a lot of food for you and actually look quite ornamental, it's definitely these guys. The kalo, also known as the taro. And they got a couple different varieties. There's a lot of different heirloom varieties of the taro or kalo. In addition, they got some comfrey, which is really good to add nutrients back to your soil, also for use as an herbal. It's known as bone heal, actually. So I actually took some when I broke my bones, I broke two bones. But this guy is actually quite ornamental. The other thing that actually I learned today is that actually the taro or the kalo will actually throw off little baby plants. So as you have your main growth, it'll actually just sprout out little babies off to the side, and you can actually dig those guys up and then replant them, give them to friends so that you can actually grow more food. And the kalo or the taro is a root crop that's traditionally cooked and then fermented and eaten. So it's actually very high in the probiotics and other good things for you. So another plant that I want to show you guys is this guy right here. This is known as the edible hibiscus or belay. And this grows as a tree. I mean, this tree is like 12 feet tall. I'm standing next to it. I mean, this is just an offshoot. The other thing is just real tall all the way up there. There's some buds that haven't opened yet. They make nice, beautiful flowers. But the cool thing about this tree is literally, imagine just picking the leaves off your tree and eating them. Wow, nice mild lettuce-like flavor in a tree. Literally, you guys plant this once, you grow it, and you can eat all the leaves. Now, I wouldn't eat some of the bigger leaves personally, but I would pick these nice little baby small leaves. I mean, man, these guys are delectable. I mean, it's really that easy to grow food. You don't have to have a vegetable garden. You can have a bunch of trees and just pick the leaves and eat it. I also like my vegetables, so let's head over to the vegetable area and show you guys some of the vegetables they're growing as well. So now we're going to show you guys the main part of their garden. It's their edible raised bed garden without the sides. So they got basically mounds of soil or compost that they brought in because they enriched the soil to have it even more fertile than the ground that was just pre-existing. I always recommend you guys do this no matter where you live, because you don't know what's in the ground, what's been sprayed on the ground, or the nutrition in the ground. You're going to have a much higher level of success if you bring in compost. And be sure to check my past episodes where I talk about soil and what to put in the soil to make it grow the healthiest stuff organically without chemical fertilizers and all this kind of stuff. So as you guys can see, they got little raised beds there. They look nice and pretty. And we're gonna go over some of the specific crops that you can grow in Hawaii. I mean, due to the nice tropical weather, you know, some things will grow really well and some things are not gonna grow at all. So we're gonna share with you guys some of the things that are gonna grow really well, and if you live in Hawaii, these are some of the things you're gonna wanna plant. So one of the things you're gonna wanna plant are these guys right here. These guys, actually, I could grow in California year-round, actually, and they're quite hardy. Even in 114 degree Las Vegas weather, or, you know, 29 degree California weather, I have seen these guys thrive, and they definitely like the nice humid tropical weather here in Hawaii as well. These guys are the Swiss chard. So the Swiss chard, they got a couple different varieties here. You know, if you're gonna plant Swiss chard, I'd recommend you guys get the rainbow Swiss chard mix. It has a mixture of Swiss chard varieties, and some of the varieties have, like, you know, white stems, some of them have pink stems, some of them have yellow stems, some of them have red stems, and they all look a little bit different. But let me tell you, all these little guys are nice and delicious. Here's this little baby plant. And I want to encourage you guys, you know, when you're growing your garden, no longer do you have to, you know, eat what the store is dictating to you. If you go to the store, you have to buy the, you know, the Swiss chard, like, full, nice, large leaves. Now, let me tell you, when the leaves get larger, it doesn't taste so good anymore. The nice baby leaves are the delectable leaves that taste real good. Mmm. And they're nice and tender and delicious. The larger leaves, if they do get larger on you and you forget to pick them when they're not small, I would then use those for, like, if you want to cook them up and make a fresh vegetable juice or even something like a green smoothie. All right, so now we're looking at another crop they're growing. They have a nice bed here of this thing. Let me go ahead and move this aside and let's see if you guys can see what it is. You guys see what that is? There's these little red things down there. Or, I don't know, maybe they're pink. Depends if you're colorblind or not. But what these guys are, go ahead and pick one up. So cute, look at these. These are radishes. Radishes are an amazing food. It's highly unfortunate that most people grow the radishes and only eat the bottoms. I want to tell you right now, straight up, that you can actually also eat the radish greens. Let's go ahead and find one that doesn't have a lot of dirt on it. You guys could also eat the radish greens. The best way to do it is while it's still attached to the plant. Mmm. Now that has a nice hot and spicy flavor, like stronger than the radish does. So you might not want to use a whole bunch, but if you're picking a salad of other greens, you know, pick a small few of the baby little radish leaves. And of course, you know, I'd probably use this more as a famine food and cook them up, juice them up, or blend them up if I didn't have much else to eat. But radish leaves are not my first choice to eat. Mmm. The baby ones taste a little bit better. Now the cool thing about the radish, these are excellent plants to grow if you're one of those impatient people, you like instant gratification, right? Because the radish can be ready in as short as 20 days. They grow really fast, they come on strong, and you'll have a lot of radish greens. So let's go ahead and pop this guy out and see what it tastes like. Mmm, crunchy, sweet, uber delicious. So the next crop they're growing right here behind me in a nice little raised bed without the sides, and I do have a video on that already, is the beets here. So the beets, you know, they are related to spinach, and so just like spinach that you eat the greens, you can also actually eat the beet greens. You don't just have to wait and eat the beet itself, right? The beet greens are an amazing green to eat. You could just pick the little small baby leaves. Let's go ahead and pick a little baby leaf here. Little small tiny baby and eat it. Mmm. Nice mild flavor, quite good actually. Once again, I always encourage you guys to eat the baby leaves. Now when these guys get bigger, you could actually pick the beets and eat them. Use all the greens. And the thing I want to remind you about the beets is that there are many different varieties of beets. You might think, oh, John, beets are those like red kind of purplish things, you know, that you eat. Well, they got like yellow ones. They got like, you know, ones that are like Chioga beets that have like red and kind of white rings inside. And some beets get like super gigantic. So another crop you're gonna wanna grow if you're impatient are these guys right here. This is a whole nice bed of arugula. Arugula is yet another leafy green that's gonna grow really well in Hawaii and tastes good too. Once again, I like to harvest the little baby greens off these guys. Hey, I'm getting a whole salad today. Mmm, quite good, mildly spicy, super delicious, would make a great addition to a salad. So we're looking at yet another leafy green, and I want to remind you guys that leafy greens are probably some of the easiest things to grow. They've done an excellent job here. It looks really pretty, really nice. Looks like something that could be in your front yard. And these leafy greens here are the dinosaur kale, also known as Tuscan kale, lacinato kale, or black kale. And they got a whole bed of these guys. And you guys saw earlier the five-year-old plants. Well, these are some babies. So these guys are gonna taste a little bit different than those ones that are more mature and older. So I definitely like, once again, you know, I love my baby leaves, and I want to encourage you guys to eat all your baby leaves. And once again, when you're growing your own stuff, you get to choose when you're going to harvest them, you know, and harvest the small baby leaves for the most tasty, delicious salad ever. So before we get into another leafy green that I'd recommend you guys growing, we're going to talk about this guy right here. As you guys can see, we got a nice herbaceous plant, and this is actually known as the holy basil. So wait, let me bow to the holy basil. But the holy basil is actually a quite medicinal basil, but also it's quite good too if you want to make a pesto. And basil is one of the most excellent herbs that's going to do well and grow well in Hawaii here with its nice mild climate. Wow, really flavorful, actually quite sweet. I definitely would recommend, you know, picking a few basil leaves in your mixed green salad. I think it goes well with all the greens I've eaten today. Let's talk about another leafy green right back down in here. This is probably my favorite green, believe it or not, of the whole garden. And if you live in Hawaii, this is definitely the one you want to plant. This one is known as water spinach, also known as Kang Kong, also known as Ong Choi, depending on what language you're in or what language you're speaking. I like to call it water spinach. It loves the water. We're in the rain right now. I'm, you know, filming this in the rain for you guys. Hopefully the camera doesn't fry out. But the water spinach loves the water, and it's actually quite good. This does not taste like the spinach you're used to. It doesn't have that weird oxalic-y flavor. It's not even related to the standard spinach plant. It is quite, however, a leafy green. It is quite good. It's a rare treat that I get to taste this stuff. It has a nice, mild, like, lettuce-like flavor, so it's really agreeable, especially if you have kids that don't like the kale. They're probably going to like the water spinach and that edible hibiscus you saw a little bit earlier. So one of the things people always say, John, gardening takes so much time, man. I don't got the time to do this, you know. Well, so what I want to say to you is, you know, make some time to garden. It is very important to be able to grow your own food to eat. I mean, we all got to eat every day, and just by making small investments of time, here and there, you can actually grow a lot of food. So you guys saw all the different garden beds that I just showed you guys where they're growing all the different things. They planted those out, you know, a month or two ago. And just today they planted this little bed out here. And I mean, planting this bed out took, I don't know what, half hour to plant the little babies in there. And you know, if they come back in a month, this is gonna be ready to eat. And here in Hawaii, everything rains, so they didn't have to water it or nothing. And they're gonna have some food. I mean, it really is that simple and easy to garden. And once you have it set up properly, it's not gonna take that much time either. So besides just being a gardener and growing your own food, gardeners are growing something even more important than their food, in my opinion. And what's that? It's the soil. The soil is the food that feeds the plants that then the plants feed you. And I really want to encourage you guys to work on and build your soil by adding organic amendments, such as the compost, whether it's a thermal-based compost, whether it's the thermophilic compost, or whether it's a fungal-dominated compost, the low-heat compost, whether it's the worm castings or their insect grass, or rock dust, or kelp meal. All these kind of things are really good for your soil and going to build it up. Another thing I like to use is the compost teas. And what we're seeing here behind me is their compost pile. Now besides just the compost they make here, they also bring in other compost, so they have a nice blend of different nutrients coming into their garden here. They use a mushroom compost and also composted horse manure with the wood chips in there that makes an excellent soil that's growing everything you've seen today. All right, check it out. I like stealth airplanes, well, when I was a kid, and I like stealth plants or stealth edibles that you can grow in your garden. Here's yet one of them. I mean, once again, this guy looks just like a nice ground cover, and while it is covering the ground, it's also making edible food that you could eat, but the majority of them are actually under the ground. And this is a sweet potato vine. It grows prolific here in Hawaii, and they got two kinds. They got a purple kind, a green kind, and you can actually also eat the leaves of the sweet potato vine. So most people will cook them up. I know there are varieties that are grown specifically for the leaves and not for the tubers, actually, which they don't make. But yeah, you could cook up the leaves and cook up the tubers, or even eat the tubers raw once in a while. Definitely a good thing to grow lots of food, making cover a ground area really fast, make it look nice and pretty so that your neighbors don't bat an eye. All right, so check it out. I want to show you guys like some fruit trees that they're growing. Now they have a wide variety of fruit trees, from cacao, which is the chocolate tree, from coconut palms to citrus, and all different kinds of fruits. They got one here, a standard papaya that's really easy to grow. In addition, they got a banana above it. So papaya on the bottom, banana up top. The next tree or fruiting tree that I want to show you guys is one that's really easy to grow here in Hawaii, but most people won't ever do it because they don't like how the fruit tastes. So let's check that one out. So what we're looking at now is the noni tree. Check it out. Here's a little noni fruit. It's just about ripe. You guys can see it's nice and yellow. Now you would never pick one of these and just eat it, right? I've actually one friend that likes to eat the nonis when they're fully ripe. They kind of have like a cheesy like flavor, right? They're kind of funky. They're not necessarily a sweet fruit by any means, but they're a very healing fruit. You know, they have done a lot of studies on noni that say it's really good for you. But the problem is most people don't like to eat the fruit. So actually on this trip to this garden here, I've learned a special way to make noni fruit juice and have it actually be palatable, so you will get the benefits of the noni. Let me go ahead and show you guys that next. So check it out. This is how you guys could make some noni juice. Super simple, super easy. What you're gonna do is you're gonna go ahead and harvest the noni once it starts to turn, you know, the yellow color. Then what you're gonna do is you're just gonna put it in a nice big jar with a rubber lid on it. You know, so this is airtight. No air is getting in there. Before you put the noni in here, you're gonna wash them really good, make sure they're clean. Then you're just gonna set these guys in the sun. This works better in the summertime when it's nice and hot, when it's not raining all the time, there's a big cloud cover. And what's gonna happen inside here is that these nonis will actually ooze or seep, and all the liquid will come out of them, and you'll be left with the noni liquid in the bottom. You guys can see in there, there's just a little bit of liquid in there, and then the nonis will literally shrivel up and dry up like a raisin. You're then gonna take out the nonis out of the jar, then maybe pour the liquid through like a nice sieve or cheesecloth or nut milk bag, get all the liquid out, and then you're gonna save that and put it in your fridge and be able to drink that to get the nutrition out of the noni, and you're just gonna compost the shriveled up dried nonis. So this is an excellent way that I learned about today on how you could now get some excellent nutrition from the noni in ya without getting that harsh flavor. All right, so that brings us to the end of this tour of this homestead where they're growing lots of fresh fruits and vegetables in their yard, and sharing with you guys how you guys could do it too. But before I go, actually I wanna, you know, get a few words from the gardeners on why it's so important to grow your own food and why they're growing their own food in their yard. So now we're with Paul and Kelly, the gardeners here, and they have an important message that they wanna share with you guys.
So basically we want people to grow their own food. So we're happy to have this garden be here right now in the backdrop to just encourage you all to start putting your hands in the earth and growing your own.
And to experience the life cycle of the plant. So there's that beautiful seed that you get, and you get to put it in the ground and watch this whole life cycle where the plant grows. You get to eat some of the baby greens, experience the flavor of that. You get to watch it grow to maturity, and then you get to harvest right from the land and enjoy it, which is so sweet and so connected versus the idea of buying it from the store, just having it right there, watching the whole life experience.
The connection is so beautiful.
Definitely agree. I mean, we all need that nature connection. We are creatures from nature, and we're getting so isolated from nature in this day and age with the monetary system, going to the store and buying stuff. We're so disconnected with the food system, where it comes from, whether it's, you know, plants or even animals. You know, people buy animals in nice little packages, man. Raise your own animals and kill them if you want to eat them. Don't just buy the nice little package. So I've really had fun hanging out with Paul and Kelly today. And if you guys want to hang out with them too, they actually have they do this kind of work. They actually teach about gardening and music and yoga. So if somebody wants to learn more about your guys' work, how can they get a hold of you?
So you can visit us on our website. It's yogardenhawaii.com. We throw different events around Oahu that shares yoga, farm-to-table dinners, music gatherings, permaculture workshops. So we like to offer it and join the community together. So you can find out more or email us at yogardenhawaii@gmail.com.
And I'm a musician. A lot of my music is inspired by the garden. You can find me at Paul Izak, I-Z-A-K, music, Facebook, YouTube, and paulizakmusic.com. And love to share the music with you guys as well.
Awesome, man. Yeah, you guys are doing great work. Keep it up. Thanks, and John. Hopefully soon enough, they're actually going to have another workshop here at their place. Maybe give you guys a personal tour to see how they do it if you want. And yeah, be sure to check them out on their different websites. Paul's music's great. I've listened to it a lot. Definitely cool. I like garden-inspired music. You know, I'm not a big fan of all this music in this day and age, but when it comes back down to garden-inspired cool tunes, I'm in, man. Hope you guys enjoyed this episode. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And remember, keep on growing.
I was raised by the rhythms of the radio. But today I'm not sure the message they try to show us. With all their wish-wash, bish-bash, they got us chasing our ego. Cat Stevens gave us tools to believe in, and Bob Marley's the one keeping us lively. You got a message you sign and deliver with love, send to your family. Let it be one that always keeps us looking up, even when times are tougher. Hey, hey, highway, hey, 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 highway. So they can grow, grow, grow. Give us a roots down underground melody with freedom sound, yes. That's what we need. We need the dragonfly lullaby melody that takes us higher. So you see, this is a light that's free, and when the mind is clear,
you've walked on through the fear, so hear the wisdom call. This is a song for all, and when the ego's gone, you'll hear the joyful song you're singing.